टू कंप्लीट द ग्राउंड ऑफ क्रुएल्टी एज ए ग्राउंड ऑफ डाइवोर्स. इन दिस रिकॉर्ड ओनली आई हैव टू डिस्कस ओनली टू आर थ्री एस्पेक्ट्स मोर. एंड वन एस्पेक्ट इज that suppose one party is threatening the another party that he or she will commit the suicide. So suppose the threat is being given by one party to another party that she or he will commit the suicide, whether this is the case amounting to the cruelty or not. Here I want to refer few decisions, and one important decision which I have already discussed with you, and this is one of the landmark case particularly in reference to cruelty, and the name of the case is Dastane versus Dastane. Here the Supreme Court pointed out that if the wife is threatening to commit the suicide, if the wife is threatening to commit the suicide, so it has been pointed out here by the Supreme Court that this amount to be cruelty. Now second decision I want to put before you, Shakuntala versus Om Prakash. We have already discussed it. Here again the justice who was delivering the judgment, that was the Leela Seth. An observation made by the judge was that in this case also the wife threat to commit the suicide, and this is also being actually taken into consideration by the court and declared that this is also a conduct of the cruelty. Now lastly, one more case I want to discuss, Savitri versus Mooldas. This case actually I have discussed in relation to conduct of cruelty committed by the child. But one more thing which I want to put before you, in this case actually the wife took the poison when she was returning from the London. This was very, you can say, this was very serious step which was taken by the wife, and in this case the wife was being saved anyhow. But the proposition of law which is laid down by the court, the proposition was that when she has taken the poison, it means that this is also a threat to commit the suicide. Since she was being saved, therefore the conduct of the wife has also been categorized as cruelty. Now another head I want to put before you, false allegation is being made by one party to another party regarding the insanity or lunacy. So suppose one party is actually alleging that another party is lunatic, or the relative of that party is lunatic. Naturally it was also taken as a very serious, and the court pointed out that this is also a conduct of the cruelty. The name of the case which I want to put before you, one Supreme Court judgment and very important, I have already referred, Bhagat versus Bhagat. In this case actually the wife was alleging that the husband and all the members of the family of the husband, they were lunatic and they were insane, and this remark of the wife was taken seriously by the court and pointed out that this is the case of the cruelty. Similarly also Bombay High Court decision, the name of the case is Rajan versus Siliwa. In this case also the wife's false allegation regarding the husband's mother's character and husband's sister's character as well as brother-in-law's character, so this was actually been alleged by the wife's side that they were not a normal person, they were the person having no character, it was also taken and amounting as a cruelty. Now the last head I want to put before you. Sometime what happens, the one party is not directly commenting something against the other party. But one party is actually making a false complaint to the employer of that party. False complaint to the employer of that party. So here, if some complaint is being made to the employer of the husband or the wife, naturally, if the allegation or the charge which has been made, if later on it is proved as a false, naturally it has also been categorized that this is a conduct of the cruelty. And the name of the case I want to put before you, Lajwanti Chandok versus O.N. Chandok. This is the decision in 1982. And here actually wife wrote a false anonymous letter to the employers of the husband. False anonymous letter written by the wife to the employer of the husband. This was also considered court as a conduct of cruelty. Similarly, also another case which I want to put before you. The name of the case is Kiran versus Surin. And this is the decision of 1982. In this case, actually, the husband was occupying a very good position. He was actually class one officer in Ministry of External Affairs. And here the wife wrote a letter to the superior officer of the husband. And because of that, the reputation of the husband was being damaged. It has also been categorized that this is a conduct of the cruelty. So there are so many cases you can get here. And under these cases, if there is a complaint from the side of the husband or the wife, then naturally, this was not direct complaint, but this was the complaint to the employer of the husband or wife. Naturally, it will create a mental agony in the mind of the first party. Therefore, it has been considered as conduct of the cruelty. Now, something I want to put before you. There are certain, sometimes mischievous activities are also being done by the wife. Mischievous means here the activity is not going to damage anything. But actually this is the mischievous activity which is being done by the wife against the mother-in-law. And the name of the case is Narayan versus Prabha. This is the decision of the Punjab High Court. Narayan versus Prabha. Here actually the wife was disobeying the mother-in-law. Mother-in-law was also a typical mother-in-law. She wanted that daughter-in-law should always be obedient. She also wanted that daughter-in-law should take bath by hot water, but she was taking the bath by the cold water. Apart from that, mother-in-law also directing her not to meet the neighbor, not to go for pictures, but it was resented by the wife. And moreover, one day, the daughter-in-law destroyed the mother-in-law's tobacco. So this was actually considered that these are the activities which are the mischievous activities. And the court has not taken it very seriously, and this conduct has not been amounting to be cruelty. So these are the few cases I want to discuss with you. Moreover, now we are in a position to conclude whole cases at one point. Now my view, which I have already submitted to you, that whether any hard and fast rule has been laid down by the court, that which conduct is coming under the category of the cruelty and which conduct is not coming under the conduct of the covenant. Now we can very well conclude that there is no any hard and fast rule which is laid down by the court. No scale has been actually laid down by the court. No parameter has been laid down by the court by which we are able to judge that what conduct come under the category of the cruelty and what conduct does not come under the category of the cruelty. So now this is final remark of mine. If any person having any deviation, now I am inviting that we can discuss it. Any person? My concluding remark is very clear. No hard and fast rule laid down by the court. No parameter has been laid down by the court. No scale has been laid down by the court to judge the conduct as a conduct of cruelty. But actually, from case to case, from the fact and circumstances of the one case to another case, it has been judged by the court that whether it is coming under the conduct of cruelty or not. Any question? Any person having any question? Are you getting my voice? Come out. Please come out, any person.
Yes, sir.
Please tell. What is your opinion? Shailesh. Do you have any opinion? Shailesh. Please come out with the voice. Tell. Ravish Dubey.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Tell.
सर इंसेंटी को एक ग्राउंड बनाया गया है कि इसके ग्राउंड इसके जरिए डिवोर्स का पिटीशन फाइल किया जा सकता है 13(1) में. तो सर जब क्रुएल्टी कोई क्रुएल्टी ऐसा करता है या कोई कंडक्ट ऐसा करता है इनसेन पर्सन जब ये प्रूफ हो जाए कि वो इंसेंटी के सिचुएशन में किया है तो उसे फिर क्यों सर एक्सक्यूज की तरह क्यों नहीं उसे दिखाया जा सकता सर डिफेंस क्यों नहीं हो सकता वो
क्योंकि एक आदमी इंसेन है और दूसरे आदमी जो है उसको जबरदस्ती कंपेल किया जाए कि वह इंसेन के साथ रहे तो क्या ये जस्टिफाइड है
नहीं सर ये तो ठीक है सर ये तो सही है कि उसे ग्राउंड बना दिया गया लेकिन जहां पे इंसेन व्यक्ति से अगर कोई ऐसा कुछ होता है कंडक्ट जिसे क्रुएल्टी के अंडर में रखा जाता है तो सर उसे तो एक्सक्यूज डिफेंस की तरह उसे प्रोवाइड होना चाहिए
नहीं बट दिस इज नॉट क्रिमिनल लॉ This is the civil law. Your intention does not play important role. That's why earlier in the opening I have pointed out, so far as the conduct of the cruelty is concerned, intention does not play any important role. So whether the person is insane or the sane, where he is inflicting the injury to the opposite party, naturally the opposite party sustained the injury. Injury may be either physical or injury may be either mental. So that's why here the main consideration, particularly in the case of the cruelty, is that what injury the other party is sustaining. That is the main parameter. Are you getting my thing?
Yes, sir. But ye natural justice ke thoda sa contradicting nahi hoga sir ki dusre party ki matlab कोई उसके
क्या ये भी जस्टिस है कि क्या ये भी जस्टिस है कि एक आदमी को पागल के साथ रहने के लिए कह दिया जाए पागल कब क्या करेगा कोई ठिकाना है
नहीं सर अगर जैसे मैरिज से पहले पागल नहीं था वो इंसेन नहीं था
नहीं, नहीं, जो भी था बाद में तो हो गया अगर बाद में एक इंसेनिटी आई है तो इंसेनिटी अगर बाद में आई है तो भी क्या आप कह सकते हैं कि जो है वो ये जो है बुरा नहीं है
तो सर, हेलो सर
it is treatable. Whether there are medicines so that he is well treated. He has become.
No doubt. Your question I am getting. So far as the curability concept is concerned, here it has not been mentioned whether the disease is curable or incurable. What is mentioned that if one party is doing something by which either physical injury or the mental injury will sustain, naturally the party will be injured, and this is enough for the curability. Okay,
sir.
Irreparable breakdown of marriage. Actually, irreparable breakdown of marriage, it has a long history. Breakdown is no doubt provided here as a ground of divorce under 13(1)(a). Two grounds are mentioned. But actually here, the grounds which are mentioned, this ground also having some other grounds. Suppose restitution of conjugal right decree has been passed and the parties are not able to restitute together. Suppose that this judicial separation decree passed and the party is not able to cohabit, then it has been made as a ground for divorce. It means what? It means that here there is requirement of some court's decision, court's order. Irreparable breakdown, there is no requirement of any court's order. Preliminary, there is no requirement. If the parties are not able to live or cohabit together for a longer time, in 1981, one bill has been introduced, and that bill providing the period for irreparable breakdown is for 3 years. If the party continuously is not able to live together, cohabit together for 3 years, Naturally, this is the case that the marriage is actually been broken down. And similarly, also in 2010 and 2014 also. In 2014 also, here actually some amendment is introduced. Some bill has been introduced. But unfortunately, the bill was being lapsed. Here again, the irreparable breakdown has been considered to provide for the Hindu society as a ground of divorce. But actually, unfortunate is that bill is not successful and bill was being lapsed. Therefore, it cannot be made as a ground for divorce. Any more question?
Sir? सर कल आपने जो बर्थ ऑफ एन इलेजिटिमेट चाइल्ड बताया था एज अ ग्राउंड ऑफ क्रुएल्टी मेंटल क्रुएल्टी उस केस में सर अगर सेक्शन 12(2)(b)(2) की जो कंडीशन है 1 ईयर की उसमें अगर पिटीशन फाइल नहीं होता है और प्रेगनेंसी
वही इसीलिए मैंने कल एक्सप्लेन किया ना
सर वो प्लीज एक्सप्लेन कर दीजिए एक बार
12(1)(d) है नॉट 1(b) दिस इज 12(1)(d)
यस सर 12(1)(d)
हां वेयर द condition is specified. If the wife is pregnant at the time of marriage by other person, it is very clearly written. But here what is required, that petition must be filed within 1 year. Suppose the husband is not able to file the petition within 1 year, then it means that he will be compelled to live with that lady who had been the mother of a legitimate child, whether this is not mental agony. And if it is a mental agony, naturally it is being also considered that this is a conduct of the cruelty, and on that ground the divorce they will be passed. Okay
sir.
Now we are proceeding towards another ground, and this ground is insanity. Here insanity has also been taken as a ground for divorce, but the meaning of insanity, which is being explained It is very technical one. The definition is very technical definition. We can say the definition which is given under Hindu Marriage Act. This definition actually borrowed from the Matrimonial Causes Act under the English legal system. But when this definition is being added, I am unable to know that what legislature wanted to achieve by adding this definition. Very technically medical, very biological definition is being added. I am just putting before you the wordings which are used here, the language which is used, that if the respondent has been suffering continuously or intermittently from the mental disorder of such a kind and to such an extent that the petitioner cannot reasonably be expected to live with the respondent. So now here, mental disorder, insanity is being actually explained by the word mental disorder, and mental disorder should be of such a kind and such an extent that petitioner cannot be reasonably expected to live with the respondent. So here focus point in the insanity is given on the point of the mental disorder. This is actually mental disorder which was being considered. And mental disorder should be of such a kind and also to such an extent that petitioner cannot be expected to live with the respondent. Very technical definition. What is the mental disorder? Explanation is attached in the bare provision. Go through the bare provision. Explanation is attached. What is the meaning of mental disorder? Mental disorder means, here, mental disorder means mental illness, arrest, incomplete development of mind, psychopathic disorder, or any other disorder or disability of mind, including schizophrenia. Each and every word is very important. Mental disorder means what? The first word which is used, that mental disorder means the illness. This is mental illness. Arrest. Arrest means mental arrest. There is one thing, mental arrest means when the mind is being actually not fully developed. Similarly, also incomplete development of mind. It means the mind has not been completely developed. And the example you can get in the society, there are certain persons who are achieving the age of the 30 and the 40, but they are behaving like the child. So here why? The reason is very clear that here the mind of that very person either not completely developed or the mind is being arrested. So here, this is also a technical thing which is being used. Apart from that, proceeding another word, psychopathic disorder. This is another technical word which is being used. Psychopathic disorder or any other disorder or disability of mind, including schizophrenia. Now, very peculiar definitions, very peculiar words are being used. Now, what is the psychopathic order? It is again explained in the another explanation, which is attached along with this section 13. Psychopathic disorder is persistent disorder or disability of mind. Persistent disorder or disability of mind, whether or not including some normality of intelligence, which results in abnormally aggressive or seriously irresponsible conduct on the part of the other party. Here the word which is used, that is very important, go through that words. Persistent disorder or disability of mind. It means disorder or disability must be persistent, continuous. And it results into abnormally aggressive. Abnormally aggressive means this is not normal aggression. Abnormally aggressive. Suppose the wife is suffering from this disease एंड एबनॉर्मली एग्रेसिव मीन सपोज शी हैड शी हैज नाइफ इन इन हर हैंड देन शी अटैक बाय दैट नाइफ टू द हस्बैंड एबनॉर्मली एग्रेसिव वॉट एवर द थिंग विच द वाइफ और द हस्बैंड हैज इन हिज और हर हैंड बाय दैट थिंग दे मे अटैक दिस इज कॉल्ड एज एबनॉर्मली एग्रेसिव द सेकेंड वर्ड seriously irresponsible conduct. The conduct is seriously irresponsible. What do you mean by that? Conduct should be seriously irresponsible. Every conduct which we are doing, we are responsible for that. Firstly, we consider that what will be the result of that conduct. Then we are doing that conduct. But when the party is not in a position to understand that what result will happen by his action, then it is called as irresponsible conduct. And this irresponsible conduct is not the normal, but it is required that it should be seriously irresponsible. So that's why here, this is the seriously irresponsible conduct. This is seriously irresponsible conduct. It has been categorized under the category of this insanity. Now, some more word, whether or not it is required or is susceptible to medical treatment. So here, curability, medical treatment means whether it is curable or incurable. It is immaterial. Even though it is curable, but when the conduct is abnormally aggressive or when the conduct is seriously irresponsible. So even though it is curable, but one cannot expect the other party to live with the first party. So that's why it is being considered that these are the conduct of the insanity. Now, one thing I have already pointed out. This is only the definition which is given, very complicated definition. And we can say this is the definition which is very much useful for the medical students. But in spite of that, this definition is being given under for the law students. So we have to discuss it. Now I want to discuss the cases, that what cases are particularly in regard to mental illness. The case which I want to put before you, Bandana versus Suresh Charan. Here it has been pointed out, mental disorder or schizophrenia should not be considered as a ground of divorce unless and until a reasonable man cannot be expected to live with the respondent. Here, reasonable man. The test is reasonable man. When the reasonable man cannot be expected to that kind of schizophrenia or that kind of schizophrenia or mental illness, it is taken into consideration. Now another case which I want to put before you. Here, doctor's opinion. When the doctor opinion is that the mental disorder was not incurable, even though divorce decree was denied. The name of the case is Surinder Singh versus Pawan Verma. Why it is denied? The reason is very clear. It is denied that the word here curable, incurable is not written. What is written? It is written that when a reasonably cannot be expected that one party should live with the other party. But that part has not been proved. Only certificate was being actually adduced before the court of law that one party was suffering from incurable mental disorder. It is not sufficient. Some more thing required to be. Here, one thing more, I think that you have already studied the Civil Procedure Code. अंडर द सिविल प्रोसीजर कोड देयर इज ऑर्डर 32. अंडर ऑर्डर 32 प्रोविजंस आर बीइंग मेड दैट हाउ ए अनसाउंड माइंड पर्सन माइनर हाउ ए माइनर और द अनसाउंड पर्सन बोथ द प्रोविजंस आर फॉर बोथ दैट हाउ अनसाउंड माइंड और द माइनर पर्सन कैन फाइल द सूट. Here, actually, if you go through the order 30, you will find that in order 32, rule 15, if you read along with the rule 3, then you came on the conclusion that here, for declaring any person as an unsound mind, a preliminary inquiry should be made. So that is very important thing. A person who is unsound mind, requirement under the civil procedure code that preliminary inquiry should be made. Now I am proceeding towards the another case. The name of the case is Ram Narayan versus Rameshwari. This is actually the Supreme Court decision of 1989. And here the Supreme Court's observation is very important. And the Supreme Court has pointed out that schizophrenic mental disorder, here the petitioner should prove not merely the mental disorder, but establish that on account of that, it cannot be expected that petitioner can live with the respondent. So here emphasis is given. The second part is very important. When reasonable man cannot feel, when the reasonable man can think that it is not expected that petitioner should live with such person. Now, Alka versus Avinash, this is another case. I have already discussed this case of the Madhya Pradesh High Court, where the wife was cold, fidget, nervous, and she was not actually performing the activities of the cohabitation. She was also not able to handle the domestic things. She was also not able to explain certain conducts. Conducts means at one time she urinated in veranda and he was not able to explain it. Taking into consideration of all, the court actually declared that these are the circumstances. It was actually inferring that the wife was suffering from mental disorder. Now, so far as the test is concerned, what kind of the test, whether the party can be compelled to go for the test, and the case is Jasmine versus Bala Sundaram. This is the decision of Madras High Court 1996. Jasmine versus Bala Sundaram. Here actually the wife underwent for medical test at the instance of the husband. Medical test which was actually performed and it went against the husband means wife was actually being found sane. Now the question is whether the wife can again be compelled to undergo for the IQ test. Here the court has pointed out, once she is compelled to go for the test, then there is no requirement, there is no need to go for the another test. So these are the cases actually which are the cases which are indicating that here the emphasis is given court on the second part. And what is the second part? Second part is that when the petitioner cannot be expected to live with the respondent. One more case I want to put before you. This case is important. Why? Because one time it was declared that the mother was schizophrenic But another time when the custody of the child was being decided, she was not. She was actually being declared normal. So now here, this inconsistent approach was being taken by the court. So that's why these are the cases which I have just put before you. These are all cases. These are relating to insanity. Here, moreover, this is very complicated definition which is given. Each and every word which is being used in the bare provision, these words are actually the words which are being borrowed from the technical meanings, which are being borrowed from the English legal system, having very technical meanings. So now we can very well discuss that what is the use of borrowing such a technical definition in the Hindu Marriage Act. What was the intention of the legislature by introducing that technical definition? Whether any objective has been used by the parliament, any objective has been achieved by the parliament? Not at all. The parliament is not able to achieve any objective by this technical definition. But more or less, since this definition is given, we have to discuss it. Any question? Any question? Tell me.
Sir, psychological depression can be a ground for divorce. If not in the case of insanity, it can certainly go in the case of cruelty. What if depression, sir, if depression is of such a nature that it is certainly having mental agony on the other partner. I mean, the wife is not able to be present in the house even after being in the house. Mental depression of such an order where the parties are getting affected. Then in that case, it might come under the aspect of cruelty, if not in insanity.
Here, everything is watertight. Everything is watertight. Whether the word is given, mental depression, the word is not here used. Very technical words are used. Mental disorder. A mental disorder, again, we explained. But so far as the depression is concerned, it is not actually been used here. Here the categories are very specified. We cannot go beyond that. So mental depression, whatever the kind that may be, but it cannot be here used as a mental disorder. So therefore, this is very unfortunate that we have technical definitions, and this technical definition is out of gear of the human values and the human thinkings. So that's why I am always arguing, by adding this technical definition, what the parliament has achieved. Okay? More question?
Yes, sir.
Any more question? Please go through this technical definition, because when the question is being asked or when you are doing your practices, naturally you have to confront with this clause. So this is very important for you to go through. Next ground, actually it was mentioned earlier, but right now it is being repealed. And this ground is being called as a leprosy. The reason is very obvious. Actually, in 2019, this leprosy is being removed as a ground of the divorce. And the reason, I think that you are all knowing well, so far as leprosy is curable. So far as the leprosy is concerned, now it is medically proved. It is medically proved that if leprosy is being detected in the very earlier stage, then the cure is very much possible. And whole disease, if it is diagnosed at the earlier stage, naturally it is very much possible to cure it. But suppose it is detected later on, even then medicines came and this disease may be cured. So that's why it is being repealed as a ground of divorce from the Hindu Marriage Act, not only Hindu Marriage Act, but all the marriage enactments which prescribed ground for divorce. In all places, it has been removed. Even in the Special Marriage Act, it has been removed. In the Muslim Dissolution of Muslim Marriage Act, it is removed. So that's why in 2019, this ground has been removed. Now I am coming to another ground, and this ground is venereal disease. If the one party is suffering from venereal disease, then it has been considered that the other party has a ground for filing the divorce. But here, disease is also being qualified. Venereal disease, the word is not only written that is venereal disease. What is more written? That is very important. That venereal disease should be, wordings I am just searching. The word is very important. And the word which is used, now,
communicable form.
Yes, that is very important. That is very important. Here, venereal disease, suffering from venereal disease in a communicable form. This is very important. Communicable form means where it may be transmitted from one body to another body. So now here, the things are very clear. If the venereal disease is not in communicable form, then it cannot be a ground for divorce. But question is, how it can be diagnosed, whether it is communicable or not communicable? Because some disease, a venereal disease, they are in the beginning not communicable, but in later stage, it became communicable. So here the wording used, that wordings are very risky one. Risky because of the reason that a disease which is not communicable at a point of time, it may be communicable in another point of time. So here the words which are used, communicable. Why it is being used intentionally communicable? Why not the venereal disease itself is written? If you go through the original Hindu Marriage Act, which was being actually in 1955, you can get the wordings up for the venereal disease. Here, time period was required. What time period? 3 year time was being prescribed earlier. So if any party is suffering from venereal disease for 3 years, it has been removed. And in place of 3 years, the word is being written that if venereal disease is of communicable form. Now another thing, which was also earlier there, but it has been removed. Here it has been pointed out that if a disease is being communicated by the petitioner himself or herself to the other party, if the petitioner is responsible for communicating the disease, suppose husband was suffering with the disease. He has communicated the disease to the wife. And later on, husband files the petition that wife has been suffering from venereal disease. So this was being actually barred. In original bare provision, you will get that this is being actually barred. If the petitioner himself is responsible for the communication of disease, then the petitioner is not able to file the petition of divorce on the ground of the venereal disease. This is being actually replaced. My question is that whether it has any impact, whether it has any impact, any person may come out. This word 3 years is being replaced the word the disease should not be communicated from the petitioner himself or herself, whether it has any impact? No person coming out? Whether it has any impact? Naturally, 3 year time, which was earlier prescribed, it was thought that this three year period, it was sufficient for the communication of disease from one body to another body. Therefore, waiting for this was very longer and it was unjustified. Therefore, the period of 3 year has been replaced. Now, so far as if the petitioner is already responsible for communicating the disease, here this also been repealed. The word has not been here. But it has no impact. Why? Because of the fact that we have section 23.1a. What is written in 23.1a? In relation to the divorce petition, one shall not allow to take the advantage of his or her own wrong or disability. So if the petitioner himself is communicating the disease to the respondent, and later on he is filing the petition, that respondent is suffering from the BD, naturally he is taking the advantage of his own wrong. So under section 23.1a, he has not been allowed to take the advantage of his or her own wrong. Any question? Any question on this ground?
No, sir.
Now, I want to discuss another ground, that is conversion. Conversion, this is being called as apostasy. Technical word is apostasy. Conversion requires two things. Firstly, renouncing the religion, and secondly, adopting the another religion. Three steps. Renouncing his own or her own religion means that he should renounce the Hindu religion. He should or she should renounce the Hindu religion. How you can come to the conclusion that he has renounced? It is quite difficult, because you can get so many Hindus. They are criticizing the Hindu culture. They are criticizing the Hindu religions. They are criticizing the Hindu god and goddess. Sometimes they are also eating the beef, which is prohibited under the Hindu law. But in spite of all, we cannot say that he is not Hindu. Even though if he is not adopting any Hindu rituals, there are certain person who are also abusing the Hindu religion. So whether we can draw inference that he has renounced, he becomes apostate? Naturally not. He cannot be apostate. The second thing is very important. When he undergo for that rituals or ceremonies by which he is adopting another religion, then this is the conclusion. If any person who is converting from Hindu religion and adopting the Muslim religion, and if he undergo with the ceremony of the Muslim religion, then naturally it is very clear that this is the case. We can very well draw inference that he became apostate. He has actually converted into the another religion. So here the case of not being there, this is the thing which we can discuss only. So therefore there is no scope to continue it for a longer period. So right now I think that we want to stop the discussion. There are few more grounds we shall discuss tomorrow. regarding the divorce ground. Any more questions from any side?
Sir, I have a doubt from initial lectures. So in section 5 mention a marriage is solemnized between two Hindus. And if one person is Hindu and second is Muslim, then it's come under the ambit of special marriage. Both are not contradicting.
How it is contradicting? Because Hindu law is being made to govern the Hindu marriages. So both the parties are the Hindu. Naturally, this act will apply. If one party is non-Hindu, then this act will not apply.
And sir, in section 7 also mentioned that inter-religion marriage is not registered. Sir, in registration?
Registration is section 8, not section 7.
Yes, sir. सर तो जो इंटर इंटरव्यूजन मैजन है आप उनको रजिस्टर नहीं कर सकते तो
ये कहाँ लिखा हो
सर पारस इन पारस दीवान मेंशन की इंटरव्यूजन मैजन
नहीं नहीं बट रजिस्टर्ड अंडर द हिंदू लॉ बट रजिस्ट्रेशन इज पॉसिबल अंडर स्पेशल मैरिज एक्ट इट इज ओपन टू रजिस्टर आर यू गेटिंग माय आंसर
ओके सर
Any more question? Now the time come to disconnect yourself. Please disconnect yourself.